Means experience. Oh, all of us then. Last 17. Okay, I've written means. Okay. Do you mind score? What was the score? Ethics. Right now. Okay. 127. You're writing UPSC means also this year or only KPSC? KPSC means. Okay, but you are a UPSC as well. What is your option? Now? Anthro. Okay. 172.5. Ethics. Oh, prelims. No, I'm talking about previous main section. No. Okay, and optional? This time any option is not there. You are exclusively KPSC. Yeah, you are exclusively KPSC or UPSC aspirant too? KPSC. Kannada literature. Both KPSC and UPSC. You are writing UPSC means? KPSC.
I'm writing UPSC means.
Okay. Majority are also writing UPSC, right? So ethics, integrity and aptitude. See, in UPSC, this is one paper where you will get high return on investment. For all the other papers, you put in more effort and get limited returns. But in ethics, that's why people think ethics, you need not read anything. That is very much flawed concept. Like in ethics, for example, they had asked one question like, first thing in ethics is you have to know the nuances. That is very tiny differences are there in the concepts. For example, is there a pen? Yeah. Can anybody tell the difference between these four words? This was a KPSC question. Do all the four look similar? Are all the four words similar? I'm not telling same, similar. Okay. And can anybody explain? Okay, fine. On the board, On the board, I have written four words, which was given in KPSC mains. like pity, sympathy, empathy, and compassion. Okay, and I'm asking people, any of you, please, can you tell the difference between the four?
So, pity means feeling sorry.
Okay, and sympathy means?
Sympathy is somewhat explaining, helping the situation, feeling sorry for them. Empathy is like, we are experiencing their
pain.
Yeah, there's pain by ourselves. Empathy, compassion is doing something on that way.
You are
like
close. Action,
there will come action.
Good. See, all the four things, like for example, pity is acknowledging that somebody is having pain. For example, a street dog is injured. So you will have pity on it. You will acknowledge that it is suffering. Sympathy is you feel sorry for it. And empathy is perspective taking. Empathy goes one step ahead where you not only acknowledge that he is having a pain, in fact, you actually feel that pain. And compassion goes one step ahead where you have the action tendency. Like you want to actively alleviate that pain. So compassion is what is required. And the very term compassion means suffering together. Like you are suffering together with the person who is having that pain. Like there is one famous saying, like for example, I will give a very live example, like right now you know that millions of youth are unemployed in this country. So you will be having pity on that millions of youth who are unemployed right now. But if you know somebody, some unemployed youth personally, then you will have sympathy towards that particular person. And empathy and compassion comes when somebody in your own home is unemployed. Then you will have empathy, you will actually feel what that person is feeling, and you will actively have that action tendency to alleviate that pain. That is, you will actively try to get him employed somewhere or in some place. So compassion is what is required of a public administrator, for any person who wants to become an administrator. Compassion, and in all the four, you see the difference is active engagement. Active engagement is what makes all the four different. You are personally engaged in case of compassion, it is the highest, and personal engagement is lowest in case of pity. Okay. And in ethics, for example, even though whether they ask you or not, always think from the perspective of public administration. They are really not interested in your personal life example. They are more interested in how ethics can be used in administrative standpoint of view and what they say, work related. And I would personally prefer, and no, I actually want each one of you to have a vocabulary of at least 50 words. Like right now I can give you at least 150 words, like you can write it down. I want definition of all these 50 words. Accountability. Oh, Kannada. Kannada, I don't know. English. Accountability, one. Second is responsibility. Third is transparency. Fourth is integrity. Fifth is probity. P-R-O-B-I-T-Y. Probity. Sixth is honesty. Seventh is conscience. Eighth is corruption. Ninth is ethics. Tenth is attitude. 11th is values. 12th is ethical dilemma. 13th is crisis of conscience. 14th is public service. 15th is public good. Sixteenth is commons dilemma. Seventeenth is code of conduct. Eighteenth is code of ethics. Nineteenth is persuasion. 20th is social influence. 21st is leadership. 22nd is I told about code of conduct and code of ethics. Okay. Intellectual integrity. How much is for 22, right? I had actually written 50 words which are very key in ethics integrity and this one. Ethical governance, good governance, can anybody list what have you written till now?
Values
are written. Tolerance. Sympathy, empathy, compassion. Sympathy, empathy, and compassion. Impartiality. Objectivity. Non-partisanship. Emotional intelligence. Social intelligence. Effective communication. Okay, then again I want you to do another exercise. Just turn the page. I want you to collect the quotes of these great leaders, which includes Indian leaders and also some foreign. Mahatma Gandhi. And I also want you to give a preliminary read of this, my experiments with truth of Mahatma Gandhi for ethics. Mahatma Gandhi, second is Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel. Ambedkar. Abraham Lincoln. Martin Luther King. Socrates, Plato, Aristotle, Immanuel Kant, and for local you can write Baswana. Sigmund Freud, not really for it. Bentham. Immanuel Kant you wrote, right? And this for Swami Vivekananda, APJ Abdul Kalam. Like Warren Buffett, in UPSC they had asked one question, Warren Buffett's quote, wherein he had said that while employing somebody, look into three characteristics like integrity, intelligence and energy. If they don't have the first one, the second, the other two will kill you. Like if the person doesn't have integrity and he only has intelligence and energy, that will be counterproductive to the company. The same thing with public administration also. Like, search for these quotes. Like Albert Einstein, though he is a scientist, he has also given a lot of quotes on ethics. Like Albert Einstein says that relativity applies to physics, not ethics. That is Albert Einstein's quote. You can write that. Relativity applies to physics, not ethics. Like, for example, and I also want, like, I have given the terms, right? Integrity, I had given the term. The word integrity is from the word integer, which means whole, complete. Like, for example, a person of integrity will have a steadfast adherence to whatever his personal ideals are there. Like, you can't be 70% of person with integrity. No, it is 100% concept. Like, it not only means that you are not corrupt, it means that you are not non-corruptible. That is, even in future also, you can't get corrupt. That is what integrity means. Like, for example, you can give this example. Like, you are non-corrupt if I pay you 10,000. But if you are ready for corruption if I pay you 10 lakhs, then you are never non-corrupt. 10,000 was too small amount for you. So integrity means steadfast adherence. That is, it is a holistic value, and you are not only non-corrupt now, but you are non-corruptible even in the future. So ethics, integrity and aptitude checks for this aspect of yours. That is, not only it sees that you don't make a mistake, it also wants that you never make a mistake in future, so that we can entrust certain responsibilities on you. Right? That aspect of your personality should be there. And in ethics, I want each one of you to make one personal notes of your personal note for yourself. Like, for example, take the perspective of an examiner. He will be looking, checking the papers, and everybody is writing the same things. Like, for example, ethics. Ethics is a set. Anybody knows the definition of ethics? Ethics definition. Okay. Ethics is a set of well-founded, well-established principles of right and wrong. What a person ought to do in terms of rights, obligations, and societal perspective. So this is what ethics is. And everybody writes the same definition. Okay, that is fine. But at least try to give your own examples of ethics. Be an individual. Especially this matters more in case of UPSC. That's why best source of notes is what you make for yourself. And ethics, don't study in, I would sincerely advise, don't study ethics in 10 days. Study ethics for 3 months, give 30 minutes for it. And more of a thinking, ethics is more of thinking than reading. Once you get to know the basic, all the definition of the basic words which I give, integrity. What is integrity? Integrity is steadfast adherence to basic moral principles which you have given for yourself. That is what integrity is. Fine. And what is corruption? Any idea? You hear a lot about corruption. Anybody? Any basic idea? What you feel? What is corruption? What is hypocrisy? Hypocrisy. Telling one thing and doing the other. That is hypocrisy. Okay. And what is the opposite of hypocrisy? Right. Integrity is the opposite of hypocrisy. Integrity is you are holding yourself to the same standards as you expect the other person to live up to. But hypocrisy is you have got double standards. Like you say, you preach corruption, non-corrupt activities to all, and you practice corruption. That is hypocrisy. Fine. And corruption, any definition? Any idea?
Power abuse,
And okay, and in ethics, I want all of you to have this habit of being very crisp. Not only in ethics, in every paper, your writing should be crisp. Like you should say more in few words. Okay, like for example, corruption basically means using public office for private gain. That is the simplest definition of corruption. You are in a public office, you are using it for private gain. That is corruption. And that doesn't necessarily mean taking money or taking bribery, and that's a very narrow definition of corruption. Corruption is anything where you are repose with public faith, public office, but you are using it for private gain. That is one line definition. And corruption is derived from the word corruptus, which means to break or to destroy. Every word go to the core of the word. That in itself explains almost 100% of what that word is trying to convey. Like for example, compassion, I said, compassion means suffering together. The very word compassion means suffering together. So it almost defines what that word means. Corruption, same. And ethics comes from the word ethikos, which means character. Okay. And morals come from the word mores, which means custom. Ethics versus moral, what is the difference? That's quite fine. Ethics is external standards which are imposed on you. Morals is the personal standards which you impose on yourself. Can you give any example where ethics and morals, like explain with an example so that it becomes more clear? Being a vegetarian, is it ethical or a moral principle? Huh? Moral principle. And what is ethics? Ethics is basically societal standards, well-established societal standards. And ethics, people often confuse with feelings. Ethics is not feelings. Like, I'm not feeling nice doing this job. That is not ethics. What if you feel nice being corrupt? So ethics is not feeling. Ethics is not normative. Like if 10 people does a very wrong thing, societal norm. For example, in ancient India, sati was being widely practiced. That doesn't make it an ethical practice. Same with untouchability. So ethics is not norms. And ethics is not a law. For example, during independence, pre-independence period, there were many laws which were not ethical, but they were a law. Right, so ethics is not law. Ethics is not your feelings. Ethics is not societal norms. Ethics is not even religion. Many religions have practices which are not ethical. Like for example, the practice of parda and all, I don't believe it is ethical. So what is ethics? Ethics is well-established, well-founded societal standards, which is prescriptive in nature. It is not what human beings do. It is what human beings ought to do. That is, you have to be made ethical. You are not ethical. So it is prescriptive in nature and it is well-founded, well-established standards. Fine. And what is integrity? I've been telling it many times. Steadfast adherence to. And what is probity? Is there a difference between honesty, integrity, and probity? That's good. Anybody? Difference between honesty, integrity, and probity? See, the same difference what I talked about ethics and morals. Morals is very personal to you. Your moral might not apply to the person next to you. But ethics is common for both of you. Like for example, if you are in civil service, there will be a common ethics for all of you. But morals will be your personal moral. Okay. Integrity is steadfast adherence to the principles which you keep for yourself. But probity is steadfast adherence to ethical standards. Like it is external. Other people can see and verify it. So probity is much higher than integrity. So honesty is just the act of being truthful. Honesty is the very basic thing. Integrity is somewhat higher to it, and probity is the utmost value in public administration. Fine. So any one of you, can you name which is the most important value, three important values which a public administrator need to have? Three important values. Compassion, okay. Okay.
Selflessness.
Okay, fine. According to this, everybody will be having their own three values that do not be same for all. You?
Emotional intelligence.
Okay.
Compassion and probity.
Emotional intelligence, compassion and probity.
Maestri, morality,
Naitikata. Okay, morality. Naitikata is ethics. Naitikata is not morality. Morality kannadadalli enantare naitikata anadu ethics eradu bere bere na adu helthane kannadadalli enantare morals ke
moliya
has value adana I have been telling the same thing there is please give attention to the nuances in ethics that is all this paper is about nuances don't use words which are misplaced use the word morality for morality don't use ethics and don't use values values what is values okay for example you prefer being corrupt is it a value okay corruption is being passed from one generation to another preferences is fine but what preference preferences is fine huh emotional preference no values can it be negative values can be negative is it what is a negative value is it a value values can never be negative value by its very connotation is bound to be positive attitudes can be negative what is an attitude behavior is different what is attitude ಅಲ್ಲಿ ವರ್ಡ್ಸ್ ಹೇಳ್ತೀನಲ್ಲ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಆಟಿಟ್ಯೂಡ್ ಬರ್ಸಿದೀನಿ ಆಪ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಡ್ ಆಪ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಡ್ ಅಂದ್ರೇನು ಆಟಿಟ್ಯೂಡ್ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ವಾಟ್ ಆಟಿಟ್ಯೂಡ್ aptitude and
ability
aptitude is an ability but attitude is not an ability attitude is your whatever evaluation attitude is a learned enduring predisposition to evaluate something favorably or unfavorably that is attitude attitude is learned these are the keywords you are not born with an attitude it is learned and it is enduring that is you don't change minute by minute it endures predisposition attitude is learned enduring predisposition to evaluate a social object favorably or unfavorably what is stereotype what is prejudice right words helidnala adralli equanimity bari equanimity equanimity, EQUANAMITY, equanimity. Slippery slope, slippery slope, adandra enanta just check it. Broken window theory. Utilitarianism. Teleological approach to ethics. Means and ends. For example, do all people believe that means are as important as ends? Who doesn't believe in means are as important as ends? Is there anyone? And ethics in UPSC, see, UPSC, there are case studies. KPSC, Lioru Kedila, Gotila, I don't know. In the last two papers, they have not asked about case studies. Okay, but next they might ask. In case studies, see, it doesn't matter what you people give decision. Nobody will give a decision that you have to be corrupt. Yaro corruption maadi anta yavaritra paper alle. So, Okay, fine. Case studies, nobody knows. Case study, you haven't seen. Usually they will give you one case study and will ask you to evaluate it ethically. So in case study, there are certain facts given. Certain facts. You are on the... I will see. ಇದು ಎಥಿಕ್ಸ್ ಪೇಪರ್ ಒಂದು ಕೊಡ್ತೀರಾ ಯಾವ್ದಾರು ಕೇಸ್ ಸ್ಟಡಿ ಇರೋದು 19th ಸಿ ಇದಕ್ಕಿಂತ ಮುಂಚೆ ಒಂದು ಬೇಸಿಕ್ ಥಿಯೋರಿಟಿಕಲ್ ಕಾನ್ಸೆಪ್ಟ್ ಹೇಳ್ತೀನಿ ಲೈಕ್ ಕೋಲ್ಬರ್ಗ್ ಒಂದು ಸೈಕಾಲಜಿಸ್ಟ್ ಹ್ಯಾಡ್ ಡನ್ ಒನ್ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪೆರಿಮೆಂಟ್ ವೇರ್ ಎನ್ ದೇರ್ ಆರ್ 3 ಸ್ಟೇಜಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಮಾರಲ್ ಡೆವಲಪ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಇನ್ ಎನಿ ಪೀಪಲ್ ಪ್ರೀ ಕನ್ವೆನ್ಷನಲ್ ಸ್ಟೇಜ್ ಕನ್ವೆನ್ಷನಲ್ ಸ್ಟೇಜ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಪೋಸ್ಟ್ ಕನ್ವೆನ್ಷನಲ್ ಸ್ಟೇಜ್ ಓಕೆ pre-conventional, conventional, post-conventional. For example, all of you believe corruption should not be done. Is there anybody who believes otherwise? No, right? But having this belief that corruption should not be done is fine. But why do you think corruption should not be done? In pre-conventional stage, you will think about rewards and punishment. Andre, you know? Rewards and punishment and then see corruption yak madabaru anta andre corruption madidre jail ge hogutive adike corruption madabaru okay this is pre conventional stage of moral development first very basic stage corruption madabaru madidre we might be punished if we work properly we might get some promotion or some recognition this is the reward So in the pre-conventional stage, you do good things, you don't engage in corruption only because you want to avoid jail and you want to be rewarded for your work. This is pre-conventional stage. Okay, then comes the second stage, that is conventional stage. In this second stage, corruption madala yakantandre society nal en ankuntaro, pakkad manevaru en ankuntaro, what your significant others will think. So you want to have a good societal image so you don't engage in corruption this is the second conventional stage and you also want to obey rules and regulation this is second conventional stage third is post conventional stage where you think that it is immoral to engage in corruption like nanna ond mauliyagalige viruddhavagide corruption madodu adike madodilla this is the third and most important stage so anybody who is ethical ಯಾವ ಸ್ಟೇಜ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಇರ್ತಾನೆ ಅವನು? ಪೋಸ್ಟ್ ಕನ್ವೆನ್ಷನ್. ನೋ ನೋ, ಪೋಸ್ಟ್ ಕನ್ವೆನ್ಷನ್. ಎನಿಬಡಿ ಯೂಸ್ ಎಥಿಕಲ್, ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಡಿಸೈರಬಲ್ ದಟ್ ಯು ಬಿ ಶುಡ್ ಬಿ ಇನ್ ದ ಥರ್ಡ್ ಸ್ಟೇಜ್. ಆಲ್ ಆಫ್ ಯು ಶುಡ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರೈವ್ ಟು ಬಿ ಇನ್ ದಿಸ್ ಥರ್ಡ್ ಸ್ಟೇಜ್. ಅಂಡ್ ನಿಮ್ ಪೇಪರ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಇದಕ್ಕೆ ಕಾಣಿಸ್ಬೇಕು, ದಿಸ್ ಶುಡ್ ರಿಫ್ಲೆಕ್ಟ್ ಇನ್ ಯುವರ್ ಪೇಪರ್. ಐ ಡೋಂಟ್ ಎಂಗೇಜ್ ಇನ್ ಬ್ಯಾಡ್ ಆಕ್ಷನ್ಸ್ ನಾಟ್ ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಐ ಆಮ್ ಅಫ್ರೇಡ್ ಆಫ್ ಪನಿಷ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಆರ್ ಐ ವಾಂಟ್ ರಿವಾರ್ಡ್, ದಟ್ ಇಸ್ ನಾಟ್ ದ ಪಾಯಿಂಟ್. ಆರ್ ನಾಟ್ ಈವನ್ ದಟ್ ಐ ವಾಂಟ್ ಟು ಬಿ ಅಕ್ಸೆಪ್ಟೆಡ್ ಬೈ ಮೈ ಸಿಗ್ನಿಫಿಕೆಂಟ್ ಅದರ್, ದಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ನಾಟ್ ದ ಪಾಯಿಂಟ್. ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಯುವರ್ ಸೆಲ್ಫ್ ಅಕೌಂಟಬಿಲಿಟಿ, ದಟ್ ನನ್ನ ಮೌಲ್ಯಗಳಿಗೆ ವಿರುದ್ಧವಾಗಿದೆ, ನಾನು ಮಾಡೋದಿಲ್ಲ. ಸೊ ದಿಸ್ ಶುಡ್ ಬಿ ದ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪ್ಲನೇಷನ್ ವಿಚ್ ವಿಲ್ ಫೆಚ್ ಮೋರ್ ಮಾರ್ಕ್ಸ್. ಸೊ ಇನ್ ಎನಿ ಪೇಪರ್ ಎನಿ ಪರ್ಸನ್ ವಿಲ್ ಟೆಲ್ ದಟ್ ಯು ವೋಂಟ್ ಡೂ ರಾಂಗ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ಸ್, ಬಟ್ ದಟ್ ಶುಡ್ ನಾಟ್ ಬಿ ಮಿಯರ್ಲಿ ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಯು ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಪನಿಶ್ಡ್ ಆರ್ ವಾಟ್ ಅದರ್ಸ್ ವಾಟ್ ಪೀಪಲ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಸೊಸೈಟಿ ಥಿಂಕ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ ಹಿಮ್, ಬಟ್ ಬೇಸಿಕಲಿ ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ದಟ್ ಇಸ್ ನಾಟ್ ಟ್ರೂ ಟು ಹಿಸ್ ಓನ್ ವ್ಯಾಲ್ಯೂಸ್ ವಿಚ್ ಹಿ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಕೆಪ್ಟ್ ಫಾರ್ ಹಿಮ್ಸೆಲ್ಫ್. ದಟ್ ಇಸ್ ವೇರ್ ಇಂಟಿಗ್ರಿಟಿ ಕಮ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಪಿಕ್ಚರ್. ಸೊ ಆನ್ಸರ್ ಬರಿಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ಯು ಶುಡ್ ಬಿ ಮೋರ್ ಪ್ರೊಫೌಂಡ್. ಅಂಡ್ ದ ಸೇಮ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ ಯರ್ ಪಿಟಿ, ಸಿಂಪತಿ, ಎಂಪತಿ, ಕಂಪ್ಯಾಷನ್. ಅಂಡ್ ಪಿಟಿ ಅಂಡ್ ಸಿಂಪತಿ, ಇಟ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಗಾಟ್ ಅ ಪೆಟರ್ನಲಿಸ್ಟಿಕ್ ಆಟಿಟ್ಯೂಡ್. ಪೆಟರ್ನಲಿಸ್ಟಿಕ್ ಆರ್ ಕಾಂಡಿಸೆಂಡಿಂಗ್ ಅಂತ. ಕಾಂಡಿಸೆಂಡಿಂಗ್ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಯಾರು ನೋಡಿ ಅಯ್ಯೋ ಪಾಪ ಅಂತ ಅನ್ನೋದು, ಇಟ್ ಡಸಂಟ್ ಸೀಮ್ ನೈಸ್. ಅಯ್ಯೋ ಪಾಪ ಅನ್ನೋದು ಅಯ್ಯೋ ನಾನ್ ಮೇಲಿದ್ದೀನಿ ಅವ್ರ ಕೆಳಗಡೆ ಇದಾರ ಅನ್ನೋ ಒಂದು ಫೀಲಿಂಗ್ ಬರುತ್ತೆ. ಬಟ್ ವಿ ನೀಡ್ ಕಂಪ್ಯಾಷನ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಎಂಪತಿ, ವೇರ್ ಎನ್ ಯು ರಿಯಲಿ ವಾಂಟ್ ಟು ಡೂ ಸಮಥಿಂಗ್ ಫಾರ್ ದಮ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಎಲಿವೇಟ್ ದೇರ್ ಪೇನ್. ಟಾಲರೆನ್ಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಅಕ್ಸೆಪ್ಟೆನ್ಸ್, ಫ್ರೀಡಮ್ ಆಫ್ ಸ್ಪೀಚ್ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಏನು? ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ರೈಟ್ ನೌ ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ವೆರಿ ಮಚ್ ಇನ್ ನ್ಯೂಸ್ ಫ್ರಾನ್ಸ್ ಅಲ್ಲೆಲ್ಲ. ವಾಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಫ್ರೀಡಮ್ ಆಫ್ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪ್ರೆಷನ್? ಆರ್ಟಿಕಲ್ ಹೇಳಿ ಹೋಗ್ಲಿ. ಆರ್ಟಿಕಲ್ 19. ಐ ವಾಂಟ್ ಯು ಪೀಪಲ್ ಟು ಕಲೆಕ್ಟ್ ಸಮ್ ಕೋಟ್ಸ್. ಒಂದು ಪೇಜ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಎಲ್ಲ ಕೋಟ್ಸ್ ಗಳು ಬರ್ಕೊಳ್ಳಿ. ದಿಸ್ ಕೋಟ್ ಆಫ್ ವಾಲ್ಟೇರ್ ಇಸ್ ವೆರಿ ನೈಸ್. ವಾಲ್ಟೇರ್ ಅಂತ ಥಿಂಕರ್ ಇಸ್ ದೇರ್. ಐ ಮೈಟ್ ಡಿಸಗ್ರಿ ವಿತ್ ಯುವರ್ ಒಪಿನಿಯನ್. But I am willing to give my life for your right to express it. I might disagree with your opinion, but I am willing to give my life for your right to express it. Right to express it. So what he means, even though he does not like what you are saying, he is ready to give up his life for your right to express it. So freedom of expression is important, and how your attitude towards freedom of expression should be. Like, for example, you have all your freedom of speech and expression, but don't say anything which offends me. That means you never have this value of freedom of expression. Okay, in yen bekaru maatadu nange irritate maadbeda anta, you never have that value. Is something which you hold whenever it is impacting you adversely. Okay, and why corruption is such a major issue in the society, especially in Indian society? Why do you think we are not capable of fighting corruption? Social acceptance is there. Social acceptance is there, or social desirability is there. Like, they think of you as a fool if you are not corrupt, right? That is why no matter whatever the laws, whatever the regulation, corruption can't be handled, because there is not only social acceptance, there is also social desirability. Like, it is more desirable that you be corrupt and earn money by whatever means it is. So that's why, how to handle corruption? Corruption is a social issue, so you should change the way we are socialized. Okay, practical examples, practical solutions. ಕೊಡಿ, ಕರಪ್ಷನ್ ಹೇಗೆ ಹ್ಯಾಂಡಲ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾರೆ ಇನ್ ಯುವರ್ ಓನ್ ಲೆವೆಲ್? ನೇಮ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಶೇಮ್. ಓಕೆ, ಓನ್ಲಿ ಬೇಸಿಕ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ ಇಸ್, ಸಿ, ಡೋಂಟ್ ಎಂಗೇಜ್ ವಿತ್ ಕರಪ್ಟ್ ಪೀಪಲ್. ಲೈಕ್, ಫಾರ್ ಎಕ್ಸಾಂಪಲ್, ಇಫ್ ಸಂಬಡಿ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ built a big house with corrupt money. Don't go to their home warming ceremony, or don't enter their home. If somebody has got a vehicle with corrupt money, don't entertain them. That is what the most basic you can do, right? At the societal level, you can ostracize people who are corrupt and encourage people who are honest. Fine. So that is what you can do as an individual, the very basic thing which you can do as an individual. See, everybody has got limited powers. Within your limited sphere of influence, what you can do to end corruption? Be personally non-corrupt, and also don't encourage corruption. Don't engage with corrupt people. Fine. Standing for something doesn't mean you go and fight with that person. Just don't engage with him and don't be a party to it. That in itself will give the signal. If enough people practice this, I think in the societal level, it will definitely make a change. Itara, bring up your own thought process. Like, give one imaginary example also. Like, not necessarily that should have happened in your life, but that should be realistic and should pass the message. So make the paper interesting, okay? Don't make it very bland. And have personal involvement in writing ethics paper. Always try to give personal examples. And what I'm telling is, whether it is implicit in the question or not, always think from the point of view of an administrator. And this paper especially wants you to think like a philosopher, administrator, and a psychologist, all the three. And don't write very generalistic answers. Don't write. And try to practice writing answers. And what I'm telling is, don't read ethics in one batch, like 10 days I will study ethics. No. Think about ethics quite often, discuss about ethics, and 30, 40 minutes write down. Like, for example, I have given you around how much? 35 words, right? Huh? 41. Make it up to 100. And I want definition of each and every word. I want definition, write it down somewhere. I want definition of each and every word. One practical example regarding that word. And one quote by some famous philosopher or leader. And always, please don't become cynical. Don't become cynical while writing the answers. Cynical, are you know? ಸಿನಿಕಲ್ ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ಪೆಸಿಮಿಸ್ಟಿಕ್, ನೆಗೆಟಿವ್. ಏನು ಉದ್ಧಾರ ಆಗಲ್ಲ ನಮ್ಮ ದೇಶ ಇಷ್ಟೇ. ಮೆನಿ ಪೀಪಲ್ ವಿಲ್ ಗೆಟ್ ಇನ್ ಟು ದಟ್ ಥಿಂಗ್. ಏನ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರು ಅಷ್ಟೇ. ಡೋಂಟ್ ಬಿ ಸಿನಿಕಲ್. ಅಟ್ ದ ಸೇಮ್ ಟೈಮ್ ಡೋಂಟ್ ಬಿ ಅನ್ರಿಯಲಿಸ್ಟಿಕ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ. ಎವ್ರಿಥಿಂಗ್ ಇಸ್ ಫೈನ್, ಲೈಕ್ ಮೋದಿಜಿ ಸಬ್ ಚಂಗಾಸಿ. ಡೋಂಟ್ ಟೆಲ್ ದಟ್. ನಾಟ್ ಎವ್ರಿಥಿಂಗ್ ಇಸ್ ಫೈನ್, ರೈಟ್? Don't be cynical and don't be artificially too optimistic also, which is not the case. Be a realist. Like, acknowledge that you have got problems. Solving any problem, the first step is acknowledging that you have a problem. Acknowledge the problem and be optimistic in solutions. But don't be too unrealistic. Like, naalene corruption avagibudutte, that is the other spectrum, which also doesn't fetch good marks. And saying that nothing will change will also not help. Acknowledge the problem and try to give practical solutions and be optimistic of what is going to happen. Fine. And in paper, what you say doesn't matter. Whatever you say, you have to substantiate it. Especially in case studies or whatever it is, you can give any solution unless and until you can substantiate it with an ethical background. And integrity should be 100%. You should never give any answer wherein it seems that you are okay with being corrupt. Okay, no matter what, integrity should be 100% on paper at least. Fine, right? You are aspiring, one case study, right? You are aspiring to become an IAS officer and you have cleared various stages and now you have been selected for the personal interview. On the day of the interview, on the way to the venue, you saw an accident where a mother and child who happened to be your relatives were badly injured. They need immediate help. What would you have done in such a situation? Justify your action. ಗೊತ್ತಾಯ್ತಲ್ಲ ಏನ್ ಕ್ವಶನ್ ಅಂತ. ಯು ಸಾ ಆನ್ ಆಕ್ಸಿಡೆಂಟ್ ವೇರ್ ಎ ಮದರ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಚೈಲ್ಡ್ ಹೂ ಹ್ಯಾಪನ್ ಟು ಬಿ ಯುವರ್ ರಿಲೇಟಿವ್ಸ್ ವೇರ್ ಬ್ಯಾಡ್ಲಿ ಇಂಜೂರ್ಡ್. ದೇ ನೀಡ್ ಇಮಿಡಿಯೇಟ್ ಹೆಲ್ಪ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಯು ಆರ್ ಆನ್ ದ ವೇ ಟು ಯುವರ್ ಇಂಟರ್ವ್ಯೂ. ವಾಟ್ ವುಡ್ ಯು ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಡನ್ ಇನ್ ಸಚ್ ಎ ಸಿಚುಯೇಷನ್? ಜಸ್ಟಿಫೈ ಯುವರ್ ಆಕ್ಷನ್. ಹೌ ಡು ಯು ಅಪ್ರೋಚ್ ದಿಸ್? ವಾಟ್ ಆರ್ ದ ಫ್ಯಾಕ್ಟ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ದಿಸ್ ಕ್ವಶನ್? And what is the ethical dilemma which you face here? Dilemma, you know? Ambiguity in the sense? Okay. Ambiguity, and one of the basic traits of dilemma is both there are two options, and in both the options there are certain merits and demerits, and there is no clear right and wrong. Then only dilemma occurs. Yes. So either of the course of action you take, there will be some demerits. In this case, it is a dilemma. What will you do? Okay, think about it. After the session, I will tell. Second question. You are an honest and responsible civil servant. You often observe the following. There is a general perception that adhering to ethical conduct, one may face difficulties to oneself and cause problems for the family, whereas unfair practices may help to reach the career goals. Okay. When the number of people adopting unfair means is large, a small minority having a penchant towards ethical means makes no difference. Third, sticking to ethical means is detrimental to the larger developmental goals. Fourth, while one may not involve oneself in large unethical practices, but giving and accepting small gifts make the system more efficient. Examine the above statements with their merits and demerits. Gotagidalva, what is the question? This is very important. First one is telling that general perception is there. Tumma niyata agidre tumba kashta barutte nimge, family ku kashta agutte, unfair practices madidre career alli life munde barutte anta. What are the merits and demerits to this argument? Answer alli balance irbeku. Write about terms helinalla adralli happiness, instant gratification, delayed gratification, hedonism, hedonism. Okay, how would you approach this? See, the can jaasti odbekagilla general knowledge internal kelidra idana. What would I have been told? All of you people have been preparing for 6 to 8 months, ala. No one is brand new here. Totally new to the preparation. Totally new, but in yaru illa new and rest thing like next month aithu preparation maartta. Okay. Bidi ethics common knowledge thane idu. What to anyone? Can you? There is a general perception that unethical means are practiced everywhere. So if you are very ethical, you will face problems and your family will be facing problem. But once you get unethical, you will be better equipped to achieve your career goal. That is the question. Anybody, this is the general perception everybody has. See, if you are very ethical and very sticking to your point, you will find difficulties, your family will be troubled. This is a general perception. Once you are unethical, you can get things done. How many of you believe this is true? Huh? How many of you? I am not the authority to appoint you people. You can tell. How many of you people believe that is true? One may face difficulties to answer and call. Merits and demerits. Examine the above statement with their merits and demerits. How much you believe this statement has got certain merits? And what are the values you see here? All words are in the ಅದರಲ್ಲಿ ಯಾವ ವರ್ಡ್ಸ್ ನ ಈ ಸೆಂಟೆನ್ಸ್ ಗೆ ಯು ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಯೂಸ್ ಇಟ್ ಇಯರ್ ಸಿ ಇಯರ್ ಇನ್ ದಿಸ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ ಯು ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಯೂಸ್ ದ ವರ್ಡ್ ಆನೆಸ್ಟಿ ಇಂಟಿಗ್ರಿಟಿ ಕರಪ್ಷನ್ ಪ್ರೋಬಿಟಿ ಟ್ರಾನ್ಸ್ಪರೆನ್ಸಿ ಅಕೌಂಟಬಿಲಿಟಿ ರೆಸ್ಪಾನ್ಸಿಬಿಲಿಟಿ ಸಿವಿಲ್ ಸರ್ವಿಸ್ ಎಥಿಕ್ಸ್ ಪಬ್ಲಿಕ್ ಸರ್ವಿಸ್ ಪಬ್ಲಿಕ್ ಗುಡ್ ಅರೌಂಡ್ 10 to 15 ವರ್ಡ್ಸ್ ಯು ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಯೂಸ್ ಇಟ್ ಇನ್ ದಿಸ್ ಒನ್ ಕ್ವಶನ್ ಇಟ್ಸ್ ದಟ್ಸ್ ವೈ ಐ ಆಮ್ ಟೆಲಿಂಗ್ ಆ ವರ್ಡ್ಸ್ ಎಲ್ಲ ಇಟ್ ಶುಡ್ ಬಿ ಆನ್ ಯುವರ್ ಫಿಂಗರ್ ಟಿಪ್ಸ್ ವಾಟ್ ಇಟ್ ಎಕ್ಸಾಕ್ಟ್ಲಿ ಮೀನ್ಸ್ And how can you use it in a sentence? This ethics paper is completely 50 to 100 words and you can play with that entire paper, you can use it. And you should know where to use what. Okay. Integrity is something which you can use everywhere. Okay. Probity, same. Honesty is same. Corruption, ethics, everything. Okay. While answering this, what are the merits and demerits to this?
Instant gratification.
Yeah. Instant gratification. What is the difference between happiness and gratification? Gratification is satisfaction. For example, if you eat a chocolate, you get instant gratification.
So you're satisfying your urge,
needs. That is gratification. And what is happiness? Are they both one and the same?
Sorry?
Are they both one and the same?
Gratification leads to happiness.
Essentially, does it? And always use this Indian philosophical thinkers also, like for example, Charvaka. Charvaka philosophy is one philosophy, is the only one school of thought in India, which rejects God, which rejects soul, which rejects everything else, which other people held sacred, and it only talks about pleasure. Worldly pleasure, materialistic pleasure, Charvaka philosophy. You can think of it while acting merits and demerits, you can think about it. And another philosophy which is very popular in India that talks about four things. Dharma, Artha, Kama, Moksha. Four Purusharthas of life. Dharma, Artha, Kama, Moksha. These are called four Purusharthas of life. You can use it in ethics. Nishkam karma, you can use it. What is nishkam karma?
You're just doing it. This is not expecting
rewards. Palapeksha padde kelsa madodu nishkam karma. Okay. And four purusharthas, dharma, artha, kamoksha. All the four have got their place. And write about illegitimate gratification. I talked about instant gratification, delayed gratification, illegitimate gratification. See, words should be very impressive while writing ethics. That is the main point. You can use this word illegitimate gratification in respect of corruption. Corruption is illegitimate gratification. Illegitimate instant gratification, both. Fine. So how do you approach this question? What are the words you think you can use it in question? Almost 45-50 words, Aita. Can you use the word Nishkam Karm here?
Yes.
And public good? Ethical governance, yes. It is not an ethical dilemma, don't tell that. That is why I asked. Dilemma is used in a context where both are equally good. Okay, here it is not a dilemma, don't use this word. That's why. Don't use words which are not, which are out of context. Ethical dilemma na use madre, you have lost the impression of the evaluator. Ethical dilemma is only used in this context where you have to go to your interview, which is good. Where you have to protect the baby and the mother. That is also good. Both good, erdu olledidaga, dilemma. One is unethical and another is ethical, there is no dilemma. Don't use that word. Ethical governance can be used, Nishkam Karm can be used, public service, public good can be used. Okay. And corruption is a very common form of, this is a textbook example where an individual gains and society loses. Individual gain, individual also gains in short term. Short term individual gain and long term societal loss. Okay, that is what corruption is. And for example, there is a road contractor who is a corrupt person and he doesn't does the road work properly. Fine. Short-term individual gain happens in the form of kickbacks, like corruption, money, get something. Short-term individual gain happens. What if by chance his own son gets dies in an accident on the road because the road was not made properly? So that individual is also not gaining in the long run. So public good, in the activity of public good, you never know who will be impacted. Short term individual gain is there, but long term, even the person who is engaging in corrupt activity can be affected adversely. Okay. Like for example, think you are a perfectly rational person who doesn't care about ethics. But in the long term, even you might suffer. So it is perfectly rational to behave in an ethical manner. Even though you don't have any concern for society, even for though you don't have any concern for morality or anything, even for your own individual good, you have to be ethical. You never know what happens. Like for example, pollution, people are giving left, right and center the licenses for industrial development. You are breathing the same polluted air. Fine. So you are also being affected, your family is being affected, and an unethical society will create an unethical atmosphere which is not good for anybody. You never know what goes comes back. Karma, theory of karma, you know. What you sow, so you reap. Fine. So how do you address this question? General perception. And always try to deconstruct this thing, question. Please pay attention to each and every word. For example, there is this term called as general perception in the question itself. He is saying there is a general perception, there is no empirical evidence or there is no scientific research which is saying that you become unethical and you will get all the good things in life. So the very term there is telling that general perception to adhering to ethical conduct. So general perception itself is not a substantial proof that being unethical will lead you anywhere. So first of all, you need not agree with the statement. Okay. What does that mean that there is a general perception that adhering to ethical conduct one may face difficulties? First of all, you might not agree with this general perception because it is not based on empirical research or any scientific research, or there is no any guarantee that being unethical will make you progress in career, first. And second thing is, even though it is a guaranteed thing, it is not something you want to engage in because you uphold integrity and probity and every other things. And third thing, you can also give the example of Nishkam Karm, that you just want to steadfastly do your duty and you are not much concerned about your progress in career or something. That is a byproduct of what you do, your duty. If it comes, it's fine. Nishkam Karm, you can use that word. doing the duty without having any interest on the yes. Fine. So here, in no way you people will tell that I will be unethical for career goals or something. Use all those terminologies, and you can even discredit the very first thing. General perception is not a sufficient ground, that which tells. There are ample examples. You can actually give, there are ample examples of ethical people who have reached greater heights, and you can give even more examples of unethical people who are landed nowhere. So you need not have to agree with this general perception. So majority in Martira, you will agree with the statement in the first place. Yaradru idanna contract madadar bagge yochane madidra, anybody thought of disagreeing with the statement? Anybody? I also thought just now. Okay, learn to think, because the word is itself telling. General perception is like that, they are like this. What general perception? North Indians are, the South Indians are very good in mathematics or computer science or something. That did not be the case. There are many people who are not good at maths. So general perception are always not true. First of all, you can disagree with it. Fine. You need not have to go with the statement unless and until it has been proven scientifically, which is very difficult in ethics. When the number of people adopting unfair means is large, a small minority having a penchant towards ethical means makes no difference. Are ellaru anyaya martare, in obne nyayavagi ikkondi en martya, en difference agutha? You are nobody in the system. Yeah. How do you address this? There are some quotes and some this thing. I believe Gandhiji or some great leader who has said that a committed minority will always affect and change the direction which the majority are going. It always happens. Even freedom struggle or whatever it is, there were few committed minority people who started the movement, and later many fence sitters joined the movement and became and changed it. Nobody thought that Indians could challenge British, who were the greatest power in the world at that time. There were few committed minority people who changed the direction in which the majority were going. So this thing that small minority does not make any difference does not hold true. It always happens that committed minority will change the direction in which majority people are moving towards. For example, Raja Ram Mohan Rai, when he started social religious movements, majority people followed all the sati system and all those women suppression and all. It is only the committed minority people who change where the majority is going. So this very statement where he says that when the number of people adopting unfair means is large, a small minority having a penchant towards ethical means make no difference. That doesn't hold good, because you can give ample examples where committed minority have changed the majority. The minority needs to be committed. You can give the example of social religious reform movements. Raja Ram Mohan Roy, when he started the sati movement, widow remarriage and all, that was the period where women were totally suppressed. What was the women in this literacy rate? When we got independence, it was in single digits, 9% or 8%. Now it is not the case. So always the committed minority changes the majority. You can give ample examples. Fine. So you can write that. That's why I am telling. So extensive or the personal touch really. Ethics needs to be personal touch. You have to think like an ethical person. You have to write. Prati obra answer difference agata, especially in UPSC. Everybody's answer will be different, and I am telling, go back to those 50 words and na helidnalla quotes collect maadi, each and every words ge search in internet, accountability related quotes, transparency related quotes. Like for example, if corruption is the disease, transparency is the medicine. There's a quote called, if corruption is the disease, transparency is the medicine. And to bring in more transparency, what they have done, Right to Information Act and all those. ಅಂಡ್ ರೀಸೆಂಟ್ಲಿ ಇದರಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದು ಕ್ವಶನ್ ಬಂದಿತ್ತು, ನಾನ್ ಪರ್ಫಾರ್ಮೆನ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಡ್ಯೂಟಿ, ಡೂ ಯು ಥಿಂಕ್ ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಎ ಫಾರ್ಮ್ ಆಫ್ ಕರಪ್ಷನ್? ಇಸ್ ಇಟ್? ಹೌ? ಎಲಾಬೊರೇಟ್. ಸಿ, ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಎಥಿಕ್ಸ್ ಪೇಪರ್ ಬರಿಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ಆಲ್ವೇಸ್ ರೆಫರ್ ಟು ದಿಸ್ ಪ್ರಿವೆನ್ಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ಕರಪ್ಷನ್ ಆಕ್ಟ್. ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪ್ಲಿಸಿಟ್ಲಿ ಸ್ಟೇಟ್ಸ್ ದಟ್ ನಾನ್ ಪರ್ಫಾರ್ಮೆನ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಡ್ಯೂಟಿ ಇಸ್ ಎ ಕರಪ್ಟ್ ಆಕ್ಟ್, ಪ್ರಿವೆನ್ಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ಕರಪ್ಷನ್ ಆಕ್ಟ್ 1988. ಅಂಡ್ ಇವನ್ ಟ್ರಾನ್ಸ್ಪರೆನ್ಸಿ ಇಂಟರ್ನ್ಯಾಷನಲ್ ಗೊತ್ತಲ್ಲ, ಟ್ರಾನ್ಸ್ಪರೆನ್ಸಿ ಇಂಟರ್ನ್ಯಾಷನಲ್ ದೇ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಸೆಡ್ ದಟ್ ನಾನ್ ಪರ್ಫಾರ್ಮೆನ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಡ್ಯೂಟಿ ಇಸ್ ಎ ಕರಪ್ಟ್ ಆಕ್ಟ್. ಸಿ, ಇನ್ ಎಥಿಕ್ಸ್ ಪೇಪರ್ ಐ ಬಿಲೀವ್ ಯು ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಟು ಬ್ರಿಂಗ್ ಇನ್ ಪಬ್ಲಿಕ್ ಅಡ್ಮಿನಿಸ್ಟ್ರೇಷನ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಸೈಕಾಲಜಿ, ಫಿಲಾಸಫಿ, ಆಲ್ ದೋಸ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಜನರಲ್ ಲೈಫ್ ಎಕ್ಸಾಂಪಲ್ಸ್ ಟು ಮೇಕ್ ಇಟ್ ಎ ಕಂಪ್ಲೀಟ್ ಆನ್ಸರ್. ಸ್ಟಿಕ್ಕಿಂಗ್ ಟು ಎಥಿಕಲ್ ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಡೆಟ್ರಿಮೆಂಟಲ್ ಟು ದ ಲಾರ್ಜರ್ ಡೆವಲಪ್ಮೆಂಟಲ್ ಗೋಲ್ಸ್. ಸ್ಟಿಕ್ಕಿಂಗ್ ಟು ಎಥಿಕಲ್ ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಡೆಟ್ರಿಮೆಂಟಲ್ ಟು ದ ಲಾರ್ಜರ್ ಡೆವಲಪ್ಮೆಂಟಲ್ ಗೋಲ್ಸ್. ಹಿಯರ್ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಏನ್ ಯೂಸ್ ಮಾಡ್ಬೋದು? ಆ 50 ವರ್ಡ್ಸ್ ಅಲ್ಲೇ ಇದೆ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಆನ್ಸರ್. ಕ್ವಶನ್ ಅಲ್ಲೇ ಕ್ಲೂ ಇದೆ. ದಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಸರ್. ಯಾ, ಓಕೆ ಓಕೆ. Okay, fine. One good book is Lexicon. It is like Lexicon book. It is one very simple source. Just to study Lexicon, I think that will suffice. But more important than book, I want you to make a personal notes. That's what I have been telling here. More than book, because everybody reads the same book. And see, this is a competitive exam. You have to be better than the other person. If not better, at least different. At least different. Just don't copy. As far as ethics is concerned, just don't copy somebody else. Your ethics is your own ethics. And that is why I have said, right, you have written down at least 45-50 terms, right? I want you to write down the definition, 2-3 quotes which great people have given, and one personal anecdote. One personal anecdote, real or imaginary. Real or imaginary. Imaginary should be as real as possible. One personal anecdote, think about it, improvise it, and make your own personal notes. Make your own personal notes. Personal anecdote, definition, and then important quotes for each and every term. Fine. Lexicon would suffice. Moral thinkers. Okay. Yeah, moral thinker. I think you can refer to the Lexicon book. He has given some of the moral thinkers, but I want you to go deeper. Like moral thinker, first you become a thinker, think about it, you will have doubts, then go online, refer. I think online internet should be the best source. I think have personal touch in this paper rather than blindly following some person. Have a personal touch. For example, many of the moral thinkers might say many of the things, but what you feel, what you think, that is what the examiner is more interested, will be more interested in. And your personal anecdotes and how you have resolved personal ethical dilemmas. For example, if you are late to some function and you have crossed the signal, have you ever paid bribe to the traffic police? If you have not bribed the traffic police, what were the ethical principles which stopped you from doing that? Anyways, getting the things done is the main criteria. Then you could have bribed and easily moved away and to your destination. So give personal examples, and whatever I have told, that 45 to 50 those words, integrity, vocabulary, there is a particular vocabulary for ethics. Please focus on that vocabulary. I think keywords. Okay, fine, fine, sure. I will do that. For example, this quite straightforward ethics paper in KPSC is quite straightforward. Like explain fundamental values of civil services. What do you people believe are the fundamental values of civil services? Write down at least 5 to 6 values which you believe are fundamental. Anybody? Fundamental values of civil services. Fundamental value. 6 fundamental values. Emotional intelligence is not a value, please people. Emotional intelligence is a capability. First things first. Probity, integrity, leadership. Leadership, it is a trait or is it a value? This is what people usually make a difference. They are specifically asking for value. Value is a personal preference for which you assign certain importance. Leadership is a trait. Emotional intelligence is a capability. Integrity is a value. Probity is a value. Honesty is a value. Like that. Okay. Please make the difference between trait, capability, value. And interest. Interest is something different. So they are asking about fundamental values of civil services. Fundamental again means first things first, which are the basic which a person needs to have. 100%, that is very much required. That is fundamental. The very word fundamental, you might have studied in polity, fundamental rights, fundamental values. That means they are very basic which a person must have. Fine. Explain social influence as fundamental feature of communication. What is communication? Always in a question, try to deconstruct the question. Main words. What is communication? Communication is interaction with one another. Okay. Okay. What is the main criteria for what is effective communication? Communication is always receiver centric. Please bear this in mind. Communication is nimge anusutte neevu thumba chenagi baradu bandidira anta. That is not communication. Communication is receiver centric. What the evaluator receives from you, that is communication. People always misunderstand that communication is source centric. What a person speaks, it does not matter unless and until the person who is the receiver, he understands what he specifically meant. That is what is communication. Communication is transfer of thoughts and ideas from a source to the receiver, and it is basically receiver centric, and it has to be applicable to the receiver, and communication gets completed once he receives the feedback, whether the receiver has got the same information and ideas which the source intended to. Fine. And what is social influence? Now see, explain social influence as a fundamental feature of communication. Just try to deconstruct the question. Many people fail to understand the question and write what they see. One word communication, if they know about communication, they write about communication. They see one word social influence, if they know social influence, they write about it. These are the basic mistakes which people do. Always deconstruct each and every keyword of the questions and address each part in relation with one another. Social influence. Do you think social influence is required for a leader? How can he have a social influence? What are the ways in which he can have social influence? One is, see, for example, if I am the teacher here, I will tell you all to take down notes. You just write it down. So you are conforming to my ideas. Conformity, that is the most basic form of social influence, where I am using my authority as a teacher and telling you to write down something. This is not a big social influence. Somebody in the back, if I can't see, they might not write. Fine. So conformity is a social influence which is very basic, and it is only based on the person's capability of giving reward or punishment. If I am punishing you, then to avoid that punishment, you will conform to my whatever. See, this is the most basic form of social influence, wherein I am only influencing your behavior, not necessarily your attitude and value. You might not care for what I am telling, just write it down. It might not even pass you through your head, just you can write it down. That is conformity. So that is the most basic which we are not interested. Next is compliance. Whatever I tell, you just comply with it. That is also very basic. What I want is you to identify with me and internalize my thoughts. That is the most pristine form of social influence, wherein you become me. Whatever I tell, you really think about it, you really work on it. So this is the most highest form of social influence. Okay. Each and every question I am taking. Each and every question. Next is, what are the cognitive approaches to persuasion? What do you mean by persuasion? Yes, persuasion is also a form of communication, wherein you are intending to change the attitude and or behavior. Here he is specifically asking, what are the cognitive approaches to persuasion? This is a very technical question, actually. So cognitive approach to persuasion is, there is one model called as elaboration likelihood model. Elaboration likelihood model to persuasion. See, earlier, this needs certain more explanation. Earlier persuasion, they thought persuasion depends on few things, like, for example, you always see in ads, TV ads, they will have an attractive model who will sell you something. So he is persuading you to buy their product. But here, it is not your cognitive or thinking, you are not using your thought. You are just attracted by that whatever model is, and you are buying the product. This is a very superficial form of persuasion, and it lasts as long as you find the model attractive or whatever. And second thing of persuasion is trustworthiness. Like, for example, you always see that there is a dentist wearing an apron who is suggesting you should use this Colgate, because that white apron has got that trustworthiness. You believe that he knows something. So trustworthiness. These are not the cognitive approach to persuasion. These are the very basic and traditional approach to persuasion. Here is particularly asking, what are the cognitive approach to persuasion? What I talked about, model and person wearing apron as an approach to persuasion, it is traditional. I specifically asked for cognitive approach. Here I am talking about elaboration likelihood model, wherein there are two processes. One is, there is more elaboration. For example, whatever I give you the information, you process it cognitively, you think about each and every argument and give it a thought, and then it will actually change your belief and attitude, and later you will change your behavior. This form of persuasion is called as cognitive approach to persuasion, wherein cognitive means you are made to think. You are made to think about why you need to change your attitude, why you need to change your belief, and why you need to change your behavior. This is what is cognitive approach. It is called as elaboration likelihood, because you are elaborating on the thought and you are applying your mind and you are changing. But in form of in the case of advertisement, you are not really thinking what Colgate does and what whatever. You are just buying the product because you are attracted by the whatever the person who is persuading you. The cognitive approach to persuasion, it requires two important traits in the audience. One is, he should be sufficiently motivated. For example, whatever I am telling, if you are not motivated to listen, you don't care. So your motivation should be high, and your capability to process the information should be high. These are the two important traits in cognitive approach to persuasion. High motivation and high capability. this is the cognitive approach to persuasion. And one big advantage of cognitive approach to persuasion is it will be long lasting. It will be long lasting because you have really given a thought and you have really elaborated on what are the whatever the arguments have been making. And one important thing is it will not only change your attitude, it will also change your behavior. It doesn't mean that you have just changed your attitude, doesn't mean you will change your behavior. For example, you might be having very pro-environmental attitude, right? Who doesn't have a pro-environment attitude here? Everybody has got pro-environment attitude, but I think everybody, if they have means, would prefer a personal car instead of public transport. Yes, is anybody who has the means to have a personal car and still prefer to go by public transport? Is anybody there? Here? No, right? So here your attitude of being pro-environment is not in sync with your behavior of opting for public transport, right? So it doesn't mean just by changing attitude you are changing your behavior. But in this cognitive approach to persuasion, you are not only changing your attitude, there is very high likelihood that you are also changing the behavior. So that is why cognitive approach to persuasion is much better than traditional approach. Fine. This I think many people were not able to answer because it is more technical. Next is the cognitive approach to persuasion. Example. You can write. That's what I'm telling you. Very superficial form of persuasion is the traditional approach. Model is giving you this. You don't think about it, you just buy the product. And this traditional approach to persuasion will last as long as you have got the attractive model selling it. It won't change your attitude and you won't follow it up in your life. But here, since you have really given a thought, you have really elaborated on whatever the arguments is being made, the motivation is high, your capability is high, it is highly likely that your attitude change will be long term and it will reflect in your behavior. So these are the advantages. Explain dissonance and the less leads to more effect. Explain dissonance and the less leads to more effect. What is dissonance? Dissonance, anyone? Dissonance is nothing but that uncomfortable psychological state wherein your attitude and behavior are not in sync with each other. Like, for example, right now I said, for example, you believe that you are fairly intelligent person and you have an habit of smoking. Now I bring you a research study and show that smoking cigarette leads to lung cancer and all. That will create a dissonance in you, wherein your attitude of being a fairly intelligent, smart person and your activity of self-harming through smoking will create a dissonance. This is what is dissonance. Dissonance means that uncomfortable psychological state wherein your attitude and behavior are not in sync with each other. Fine. And the less leads to more effect on the kirtan. This is very, very technical question. Less leads to more effect on the kirtan. There was a classic example experiment done by a psychologist, Leon Festinger. What he did was he called one set of people and asked them to do some very boring tasks like arranging papers in some order or something, very boring and menial activity. And another set of people also he told them to do the same menial activity. Okay, suppose group A and group B. For group A, he paid $1 for 1 hour for doing that menial boring job, and for group B, he paid $20 to do that same menial job, menial boring job. So here is asking less leads to more effect. Here less leads to more effect means I have paid this group of people $1 and this group of people $20. Later, when asked, how did you feel about the job? They will tell that I really liked the job, I enjoyed the job. But for the people whom I have given $20, they said it's a very boring job, I didn't like it. So here, less has led to more change in their attitude towards the job. Because they have been paid only $1, they have got the dissonance. I am not liking this job. still I'm doing it, this boring job, that they will feel. That will create a dissonance. So to solve this dissonance, what they will tell is they will change their attitude that they are really liking their job and doing their boring job. But for these people for whom I have given $20, they can easily have an external reason that I have been paid $20, so I have been doing this job. So attitude doesn't change. There is an external reasoning that $20 is sufficient to do this boring job. So less has led to more change in attitude than paying more. This is what is less lead to more effect. This is very technical. Anyways, I don't know how they ask this. Okay, what is emotional intelligence? Explain its major components. Emotional intelligence. Emotional intelligence as a term. Emotional intelligence as a term was coined by Peter and Salovey, which was later popularized by Daniel Goleman in 1995 through his book Emotional Intelligence. What is emotional intelligence? Common sense answer. Anybody? Emotional intelligence, again I am telling, emotional intelligence is not a value. Don't treat it as a value. Emotional intelligence is the ability to perceive emotions of oneself and others. Ability to use emotions to assist thoughts. And ability to reason with emotion. This is emotional intelligence. And emotional intelligence is an ability, not a value. Fine. And major components of emotional intelligence also helps in recognition of emotions and regulation of emotion. You can recognize the emotion of yourself and others and regulate the emotion of yourself and others. For example, self-emotional recognition is called as self-awareness. So major components of emotional intelligence is self-awareness. When you recognize your own emotions, you tend to exhibit self-awareness. When you recognize the emotion of others, you tend to exhibit social awareness. When you are able to do self-emotional regulation, it is called a self-regulation. And when you are able to regulate the outside world, you are called as social regulation, social awareness. And empathy is also the component of emotional intelligence, major component of emotional intelligence, empathy. Fine, these are the five components: self-awareness, social awareness, self-regulation, relationship management, and empathy. Five components of emotional intelligence. So explain integrity. Describe different types and significance of integrity. Describe how an individual can achieve personal integrity. What is integrity? Integrity, one is, I told, it is derived from the word integer, which means whole. It is a holistic concept, and integer means integrity means steadfast adherence to the personal morals and principles. And integer also means your thoughts, word, and behavior are in consonance to one another. You don't think one thing and say another and do another thing. It's all in consonance. Integrity means your thought, word, and deed are in sync with each other. Fine. Describe different types and significance of integrity. Types of integrity is personal integrity, intellectual integrity, professional integrity. These are the types of integrity. What is intellectual integrity? Intellectual integrity means holding oneself to the same principles and everything which he expects the other person to hold. Like, for example, I believe that being non-corrupt is a good thing. But first, I have to live up to those expectations before expecting that from the other person. This is called as intellectual integrity. Fine. Describe how an individual can achieve personal integrity. How can you achieve personal integrity? Huh? What? Yeah, how? Describe how an individual can achieve personal integrity. And always I am telling, like, you people are not yet officers, you are aspirants, but always think like an officer. Okay. And think about it, because this is going to apply each to their own. personally, this is one place. For example, you can show your talent only when the question is open-ended. Question open-ended ಇದ್ದಾಗ ಮಾತ್ರ ನಿಮ್ ಟ್ಯಾಲೆಂಟ್ ತೋರಿಸೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಅವಕಾಶ ಇರುತ್ತೆ. ಫಾರ್ ಎಕ್ಸಾಂಪಲ್, ಇಫ್ ಐ ಟೆಲ್ ಯು ಪೀಪಲ್ ಟು ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪ್ಲೇನ್ ಇಂಟಿಗ್ರಿಟಿ, ಆಲ್ ದ 10 ಪೀಪಲ್ ವಿಲ್ ರೈಟ್ ಇಂಟಿಗ್ರಿಟಿ ಸ್ಟೆಡ್ಫಾಸ್ಟ್ ಅದರೆನ್ಸ್ ಟು ಒನ್ಸ್ ಓನ್ ಮಾರಲ್ ಐಡಿಯಲ್ಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಪ್ರಿನ್ಸಿಪಲ್ಸ್. ದಿಸ್ ಡಸಂಟ್ ಮೇಕ್ ಎನಿ ಡಿಫ್ರೆನ್ಸ್ ಬಿಟ್ವೀನ್ ಯು ಅಂಡ್ ದಿ ಅದರ್ ಪರ್ಸನ್. ಬಟ್ ದಿಸ್ ಕ್ವಶನ್, ಲೈಕ್ ಹೌ ಎನ್ ಇಂಡಿವಿಜುವಲ್ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಅಚೀವ್ ಪರ್ಸನಲ್ ಇಂಟಿಗ್ರಿಟಿ, ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಓಪನ್ ಎಂಡೆಡ್ ಅಂಡ್ ದಿಸ್ ವೇರ್ ಯು ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಶೋ ಯುವರ್ ಓನ್ ವಾಟ್ ಎವರ್ ಮೆಟಲ್ ಇಸ್ ದೇರ್. ಸೊ ಓಪನ್ ಎಂಡೆಡ್ ಕ್ವಶನ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಮೋರ್ helpful to show your caliber. And never make a mistake in this type of definition wala question. Explain integrity, everybody should be able to write same words. I am not so particularly telling those words. Like for example, I told thought, words and deed are in sync with each other. You can write it in a proper textbook definition, write it. Here, don't make any mistake. Textbook definition should be, you should word by word you should write it there. There will be keywords, don't miss any single word in definitions. I think that is one of the key parts in ethics. Write all the 50 words, there are definition for each and everything. What is accountability? Define accountability. Accountability is the value of being open to be held responsible for your activities. That is, you are open to be held responsible. That is accountability, being accountable for your actions. So define madi pratiyondanu. What is the difference between empathy, sympathy and compassion? That I told. Empathy, sympathy and compassion. Sympathy is you acknowledge the pain of the fellow human being. Empathy is you feel the pain of the fellow human being. That is, empathy is called as perspective taking. Empathy is also called as perspective taking. You stand in his shoes and feel what he is actually feeling. Perspective taking. And compassion is suffering together. And compassion has also got the component of active action tendency. That is, you are motivated to work to alleviate the other person's pain. So use these keywords, action tendency in compassion. Describe empathetic behavior at work. One very good example of empathetic behavior by Government of India, especially for men. Think about it. They pass an act, Maternity Benefit Act. Maternity Benefit Act, 26 weeks paid leave. This is an empathetic behavior at work. Okay, give this kind of examples. So Government of India has been empathetic towards the challenges which a woman faces when she gives childbirth, and also acknowledging the fact that a child requires maternal care, which is very, very essential during the infancy stage. There it has showed empathetic behavior. See, work is not just business and not just profit. It also needs to be empathetic. So you can give this example. Describe empathetic behavior at work. Explain tolerance and compassion in Indian context. How effectively can tolerance and compassion be used by the respective authority in the process of decision making in public administration? Tolerance andre eno? Tolerance. In Indian context. Tolerance. Like Swami Vivekananda had given a very good quote regarding tolerance. He had taken offense to this word tolerance. Tolerance, he said that tolerance means I believe that you are wrong, but I am tolerating you and I am letting you be. That is tolerance. But I prefer more than this word tolerance, I prefer the word acceptance. That is, I accept that you might be different, your culture might be different, your norms might be different, and we can coexist happily. That was his definition of tolerance. Not merely that, chalo, you are different and I am okay with it. Not a passive thing. Actively, you appreciate, accept and appreciate diversity. That is what is tolerance is in Indian context. Accepting and appreciating diversity, which might be cultural, religious, or the way of life, that is tolerance in Indian context. Fine. So in Indian context, it matters more. Why? Because we have got diversity in language, religion, culture, values, everything. We have got a lot of diversity. Even Kannada language is not the same. North Karnataka is different. South Kannada side is different. So tolerance is appreciating it. Acceptance and appreciation. You use these two words. Acceptance and appreciation of diversity is tolerance. And you can give example of Swami Vivekananda, where he said that tolerance gives an impression that you might be wrong and I am quite okay, I am letting you be. But he was more for using the word acceptance. How effectively can tolerance and compassion be used by the respective authority in the process of decision making in public administration? How effectively can tolerance? Here you can use this uniform civil code. They didn't bring it up. It is sort of, I think, tolerance towards this thing, whatever religious diversity is there. I think appreciating that they didn't bring it up, uniform civil code, they didn't bring it up. They appreciated that many people might be having their own way of life. You can use it as an example. Explain the factors which determine an employee's dedication to public service. Factors. Ali, words Ali, perseverance. Persistence, resilience, dedication.
is very happy coming to college but is not motivated to study. He likes coming to college meeting people. Okay, this is a classic case where he has got high morale and low motivation. Fine, this you might see even happening in work. He's happy coming to work but he's not motivated to work. Fine, so here he is. What?
Motivation.
Low motivation. Motivation is what? Motivation also comes from the word which means to move. Matlab, you have got the energy to do work. It might be a positive energy. That is again values. Motivation is not nonsense. Morale is different, moral is different. M-O-R-A-L-E. Morale is enthusiasm. In this context, I am talking morale as enthusiasm to work. So somebody is very enthusiastic to come to college so that he can meet people, make friends and all, but he is less motivated to study. And same with job. Somebody might be very happy to come to office but he is not motivated to work and motivated to work. And somebody might really be motivated to go further in his career but he doesn't like the work environment. So he has got low morale but high motivation. Fine. So here he is asking, what are the factors which determine an employee's dedication to public service? What are the factors that determine an employee's dedication to public service? Just come up with a few words which you might think will affect his dedication. Dedication factors. Dedication. There are few factors. Like for example, I think nobody is actually talking about this. He should be adequately compensated. But the salaries. There was a thinker who talked about dissatisfaction and satisfaction. No? He said that salary and all those things, if you have got good salary, it doesn't mean that you are satisfied. It means that you are not dissatisfied. And being not satisfied doesn't mean that you are satisfied. For example, now I believe all of you are not dissatisfied with your life, but you are not satisfied. Right? So, employee dedication to public service is determined by one is recognition, second is reward, third is like differential this thing, appraisal. How properly has been appraised for his work? Like whether his work is being properly rewarded. And there has been impartial appraisal of his work. Impartial appraisal of his work. Explain what is expression. What is impartiality? This I am leaving to you only. Come up with more factors. Konegaad will just come back to this question. Just think about more factors which will lead to employee dedication. And what do people think about public service? Public good? Public service is that? Public administration? Say public. Administration, the word means to serve, administrate, means to serve. Public administration is serve the common public.
that is what is going to happen. But what do you feel? What is the opinion that you should come? Okay. Ethics, I want each of you to make your own personal responsibility. That will be more than 50 pages with each and every word, definition, course, examples. And more of the thinking, personal thinking. You can discuss. You can learn from others, no need to copy from others. You can learn. One idea you can take and make it your own. Explain what is impartiality, non-partisanship, and objectivity in context of politics. Impartiality, non-partisanship. Partisanship is Swajana Pakshapat. Partisanship is you are being partial to your own people. Non-partisanship and objectivity in context of public service. How to define as define impartiality? That's impartiality is being unbiased and taking the things based on its merit and merit alone is impartiality. Impartiality is being unbiased, having no preconceived notions, and taking the things based only on its merit. That is what is impartiality. And non-partisanship is not being more favorable to your own people, being objective and being impartial, being unbiased, and being non-judgmental. That is non-partisanship. In the context of public service, how can you practice impartiality of duty or the upliftment of weaker section? For example, reservation when everybody will have a strong opinion, there will be very less people who will be having an opinion on reservation. Everybody will be having a strong opinion. Right? Other people who have got no opinion. No, right? So here is asking upliftment of weaker section. And how do you follow impartiality of people? Can you do this positive discrimination? What is positive discrimination? Positive discrimination. That doesn't mean you are being non-objective or you are being partial. So you should know the distinction. This is a positive discrimination. Affirmative action. Affirmative action and positive discrimination. Discrimination, can use these words so that you are being impartial and objective and also being instrumental in affecting weaker section. I believe the KPSC also has a performance reservation, right? And even UPSC doesn't take speech exam fees. So these are all, it doesn't mean that they are being partial towards women, that doesn't mean they are not being objective, it just means that they are being positive discrimination and affirmative action to uplift the weaker section and gain them more representation in public service, make them more empowered. Critically consider the essence, determinants, and consequences of human action with reference to JS, utilitarianism, charvaka, and communism. Charvaka, what is charvaka? Charvaka was hedonism. Only one philosophy in Indian school of thought which were hedonistic. Rest all was never hedonistic. Their only ethics is the only purpose of life is pleasure. So that was Charvaka. It is also called as Lokayata philosophy. And covers Kamayuga, Nishkama, without expecting. Utilitarianism means greatest good for greatest number of people. But what is the demerit of this? There will be few people who are worse off. So utilitarianism always refrain from using this word. Don't use the word utilitarianism. Always refrain. If they are not asked, don't use this would be utilitarianism. Because it is not entirely positive. The greatest good for greatest number of people, but there are two people who might be worse. So that's not completely ethical. So avoid this. Right, and what about ethical dilemmas in government and private institutions? Ethical dilemma. For example, there are poor people who have approached land. Now they are being an address to vacate this land. Now you find an ethical difference, isn't it? What is the ethical difference? What are the values which are being picked opposite to one another? Compassion is fine. Call of duty. Call of duty. Call of duty is coming in conflict with compassion. How do you resolve this? Like, for example, very good example is this Rohingya Muslim issue, where it had been the biggest humanitarian crisis. Okay, but now in international relations, whether to give them shelter in India or not is again a big ethical issue. Here, your values of compassion is conflicting with your duty towards the nation. Okay, but here they will tell. Again, ethically, it happens that there might be a threat to the nation's security. So you are being compassionate on humanitarian basis, but again, it is conflicting with your ethical value that there might be a threat towards the nation's internal security. So these are the ethical issues involved, like, for example, she said conditional aid. Like, for example, you are taking aid and you have to also compare to this thing. And again, being centered is being centered. Like, being should be as ethical as humans. Fine. What is the objective of RTI Act? Evaluate ethics and the performance of this. What is the objective of Right to Information Act? Evaluate ethics and the performance of that. Very simple question. What is the objective of RTI Act? Yes. That's all. What is the objective is being more transparent and accountable. Okay. Our Right to Information Act is it was an official secrecy act. This is an antidote to that. Whatever information is there, it is. What are the evaluate the ethics underlying the process of that? What are the ethics? You know, transparency, accountability, responsibility. And you can write inclusive governance. Inclusive governance. And also write, you can write about sustainable development. Use as many standard words as possible. How many words are there in your agenda? 56. You can actually write nearly 100 words. Nearly 100 words, make a vocabulary of it. What is the definition of sustainable development?
Result.
standard definition of self-confidence. And you can any word I say, I always pick up a quote which really summarizes what it is. You can use Mahatma Gandhi's quote, where he says this world has got enough for everybody's need, not for everybody's need. That is very important in terms of sustainable development. And sustainable development, you can see it in two perspectives. One is economy, one is ecology. Economic perspective also you can see, and ecology perspective also. I want proper definition. I understood that. Like sustainable development is you are fulfilling the present needs without compromising the future generation. There is a proper definition given by during the summit 1992 that one was sustainable development. Print plan commission has given the always write standard definition for each and every word. Print plan commission 1992 had given standard definition of sustainability. Always get everything for ethics also get one standard definition. Attitude also got one standard definition. Always bring up one standard definition for each and every. That will make an impact. And always drop keywords rather than writing answers. See, this is all a game of words. Ethics doesn't have anything to do with you being ethical. Okay, there are many ethical people. Let me be very frank, it is about marketing yourself in a very subtle way. People talk about soft sell. Have you heard about soft sell? Soft sell means you are marketing very subtly. In a subtle way you are marketing. Hard sell means, for example, if you know I am selling you something, you become more resistant to buying that product. Should be very simple. The same thing you have to follow in ethics. Ethics is wordplay, ethics is almost like mathematics. Okay, there are few words, few equations, you should do it properly. Good governance, we have written about it. Good governance is one standard definition, World Bank, 1995. For everything, there is one standard definition, search for it and write it. KPSC at least is all your preparation, your ability to memorize and go for a standard for each and every thing. And always never forget keywords. And even in question, I am telling you just deconstruct the question. Is there a code of ethics, code of conduct? For civil servants, is there a code of ethics? There is a code of conduct. There is no code of conduct. You can only control the person's conduct, you never know what is happening. So, the difference between code of conduct and code of ethics. You can write down what is the difference between code of ethics and code of conduct. That's what. This year, this UPSC question, sticking to ethical means is detrimental to the larger development. This was the statement. Sticking to it is detrimental to larger development. This is the argument. What would you like to say about this? Like, for this, if you use the ethical principle, that we should be as ethical as ends. If that is the case, that sticking to ethical means would not lead to developmental goals and doesn't go in sync with your values. That we should be as ethical as you can use a word. So any question, please go back to those 50 words, it will be an answer there. Only thing is you need to search. So here he is talking that ethical mean detrimental to goal. So how can an ethical mean can be detrimental to developmental goal, which is a positive thing? You want and means to be as ethical as the ends. And Gandhi always thought about this. That's why he didn't want to win freedom by means of violence. He always wanted that means should be as important as ends. Okay. may not involve oneself in large ethical practices, but even in accepting small gifts makes the system more efficient. Slippery snowball now. Slippery snowball. You can use that in this. Slippery snowball. Right? Once you are okay with doing a small mistake, then that will be the bigger mistake. Just it, like a slope. Once you are ready to get on, you will go as on as possible. That is the concept of slippery slope. There is a standard definition for this. You can use it. While one may not involve large unethical practices, but giving and accepting small gifts makes the system more efficient. So here you can use that there is nothing called as. You can also use the term integrity. Integrity is you are a completely a person of integrity or you are not a person of integrity. There is no middle. And what I understand is that relativity applies to physics, not ethics. You are not relatively a better person. You are either a better good person of integrity or you are not. So we are like the other side, but paper only you have to write. Be very clear with this. People who are scoring big in ethics are not necessarily people who are not scoring in ethics, they are not necessarily ethical people. Okay. This had happened. I'm telling you in talk. This had happened in 2016. That person in NBSC scored a very high mark in ethics. Next year, he was caught in cheating exam. So, ethics is how well you are creating a personality which is ethical, which always goes, never in the paper write that you are okay with this. That no, not big, it's not large, but it's small and okay with it. No. Slippery slope is there and integrity is there. Take care of these two concepts. You can use those two concepts here. So every question I am telling you, those 50 words only you can address each and every question. Fine? Any doubts? You will prepare one better definition. You can send it to my number, WhatsApp of this. Take down 93809799985. If anybody bigger make the definitions, I will see. I will really check each and every definition and I will check that. And crowdsource, please crowdsource if you can. Crowdsource and make a group of people and give one person an anecdote which every person can use in this. See, your cocktail is not just 20 people, there are lakhs of people. Okay? Share. At the end of the day, your individual merit will be there. But you do that in each other. Share the quotes. Like for example, I told sustainable development, you can use Mahatma Gandhi, where he said that everybody's dream, not everybody's dream. And as far as freedom of speech is concerned, Voltaire's quote that I might disagree with what you say, but I will give up my life to protect your right to express. That is freedom of expression quote. Voltaire. And integrity, what I'm saying for related to the applies to the context. So you can't be relatively a person who is integrity. Integrity, the very word says it is more holistic concept. 100% integrity. You are not only non-corrupt, you are also non-corrupt. As one officer, like Parker Shetty. Yes, one gentleman person. I had this fortune of meeting him just attended the court. He had come to our academy where like all the girls were going crazy over his books. Like, he was such a handsome person at that age. Yeah, he's almost 6 feet 4 inches tall. But such a humble person. And I'm saying it as a matter of fact, there were many people who came and gave lectures. Only this lecture, there was pit drop silence. People were just in awe of this person. He was very humble. He never talked about such a man. His total sense of humor was very nice, very gem of a person. And he is the person of 100% integrity, you can watch for. 100% integrity, one example, I believe, in the question. He was, look at this, he he had arrested himself because that is why
Restaurant. Restaurant. Previous channel.